Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Parkinson's Disease, A Complete Guide for Patients and Families, 3rd edition, by William J. Weiner, M.D., Lisa M. Shulman, M.D., and Anthony E. Lang, M.D., FRCP. Narrated by Bob Souer. Publisher's Note: This audiobook includes bonus material. Please visit tantor.com and type Parkinson's Disease, A Complete Guide for Patients and Families, 3rd edition, into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page. Then, under the Supplemental Content section, please enter the access code PARK, P-A-R-K, and then click the Unlock button to access the bonus material. The code should be entered in all lowercase letters. All figures, tables, diagrams, and charts referenced in this audiobook can be found in the bonus material. Preface. In the 13 years since the first edition of this book was published, much progress has been made in the management and treatment of Parkinson's disease. There have been important developments in understanding the basic causes of Parkinson's and the role of genes and heredity in this disease, advances in the role of surgery as a treatment, and the introduction of new drugs to treat symptoms. There has also been increased interest in research on disease-modifying or neuroprotective therapies that may slow the progression of Parkinson's. This new edition discusses all of these developments and retains the original intent and purpose of the book to help patients and their families develop a fuller understanding of what living with Parkinson's disease is like. When people first learn of the diagnosis of Parkinson's disease, they generally know little about this illness. Understandably, a myriad of questions arise. Many patients and families become alarmed as they translate their limited experience and knowledge to themselves. The fact is that the effect of Parkinson's disease on people's lives has been fundamentally altered in recent years, as new and better treatments have become available. Indeed, Parkinson's disease has become a disorder that does not prevent people from living productive and satisfying lives for many years. In fact, a large proportion of those with Parkinson's disease remain independent in the activities of daily living, ADL, 10 years after diagnosis. Understanding the symptoms of Parkinson's disease and the management of the disease is the key to each person's ability to preserve his or her sense of stability and control. There are many examples of medical conditions that are chronic illnesses, including arthritis, asthma, diabetes, and Parkinson's disease. In every one of these examples, the recipe for living well with the disorder involves having a clear understanding of both the medical condition and the pivotal role that a prepared individual can assume in the management of his or her own health. For example, in making clinical decisions, a physician relies on the history and feedback that the patient and caregivers provide. There is no one formula for the successful management of Parkinson's disease. Instead, success relies upon an individualized and comprehensive plan of care based on shared decision-making between the experienced physician and the prepared patient. We have written a book that explores Parkinson's disease in straightforward and honest terms. We have explained what goes wrong in the brain that leads to the disorder, and we have also explained how a physician goes about making the diagnosis of Parkinson's disease. We have discussed the subtleties involved in diagnosis so people with Parkinson's disease and their families understand the challenges that sometimes arise in arriving at a correct diagnosis. Parkinson's disease is a progressive problem that gradually worsens with time. In separate chapters, we have delineated the common problems associated with the early, middle, and advanced stages of Parkinson's disease. We not only discuss these problems in considerable detail, but also offer numerous suggestions based on our experiences regarding how to better live with these problems. Most people think that the major problems of Parkinson's disease relate to problems with movement, including tremor and walking. However, Patients with many years of experience with Parkinson's are also familiar with a wide array of non-motor symptoms, both due to the disease and its treatment. Therefore, we have a separate chapter, Chapter 6, in which we extensively review the common non-motor symptoms that may occur, including depression, apathy, anxiety, sweating, sexual dysfunction, memory problems, sleep disturbance, impulse control disorders, for example, excessive gambling, shopping, computer use, eating, bladder problems, and constipation. The role of drug therapy in the treatment of Parkinson's disease is thoroughly discussed in this book. In the last 45 years, impressive advances in the therapy of Parkinson's disease have been made. We outline how Parkinson's drugs work, why they are helpful, the side effects associated with them, and what patients can realistically expect of each of them. How to use medication safely and effectively, and the various drug combinations are also thoroughly reviewed, as is drug therapy for the various non-motor symptoms. The role of surgery in the treatment of Parkinson's disease continues to evolve. We review the different types of surgery that can be of value in Parkinson's disease. Importantly, we present the key questions that patients and families should ask themselves and their physician before considering surgery as a therapeutic option. The book closes with a long chapter of commonly asked questions and clear and concise answers to these many difficult questions that often arise during an office visit. The subject of each question and answer is covered in much greater detail in the many chapters within the book. Our many years of experience with taking care of patients with Parkinson's disease have taught us that well-informed, knowledgeable patients do better over time. Our goal in this edition is to contribute to a foundation of knowledge for persons who are living with Parkinson's disease in order to help them make healthy adjustments to these changes, to develop competency in self-monitoring and self-management, and to become effective partners in shared decision-making with their physician. The chapters of the book can be listened to in sequence, but they can also be listened to separately. To permit this approach, we have incorporated a certain amount of duplication in the information provided. For those listening to chapters in sequence, this can serve to reinforce the important issues covered. We thank all the patients and families whom we have taken care of over the years for sharing with us their insights, experiences, and responses to Parkinson's disease. The spirit that the Parkinson's community exhibits is an enduring inspiration. We hope that we successfully communicate the world conveyed by our patients to the larger community of persons and families affected by Parkinson's disease. We thank Cheryl Grant Johnson and Sharika Green, who have diligently supported us with fine administrative skills during the preparation of this book. We thank our editors, Jacqueline Waymuller of the Johns Hopkins University Press, as well as Alice Liam and Linda Strange, who helped us transform our initial text into an easily readable and patient-friendly format. We also thank special benefactors who have generously supported our research on this project, as well as many other Parkinson's disease-related projects: Rosalind Newman, Morton Shulman, Jack and Mary Clark, the Catherine Manson family, Lily Safra and the Edmund J. Safra Philanthropic Foundation, the Eugenia Brin family, and the Frederick Henry Prince Trust. Part 1. Introduction. Chapter 1. What is Parkinson's disease? What are the symptoms of Parkinson's disease? What causes these symptoms? What is the difference between Parkinson's disease and Parkinsonism? When should I tell people that I have Parkinson's? Whenever a diagnosis of Parkinson's disease is made, patients and families naturally ask, what is Parkinson's disease? As doctors treating people who have Parkinson's, of course, we discuss this question with many patients. But we, and they, are aware that the answer is both straightforward and elusive. Parkinson's disease is a degenerative neurologic disease. Degenerative means declining in quality. Thus, the disease increases in severity over time. Neurologic refers to the nervous system. One could therefore say that Parkinson's disease is a disease of the nervous system that gets worse over time. We also describe Parkinson's disease as a chronic progressive neurologic disease. Chronic means of long duration. Progressive means proceeding in steps or advancing. Parkinson's disease does not go away, and it gradually gets worse. Parkinson's disease is named after the English physician, James Parkinson, who first described the illness. His original paper describing this disorder, published in 1817, was titled Essay on the Shaking Palsy, and to this day, Parkinson's disease is still sometimes called the shaking palsy. Ancient medical writings include descriptions of people with a disorder that fits the clinical picture of this disease, but Parkinson is given credit for providing the most thorough description of it. Another name for this illness is paralysis agitans, which is simply the Latin translation of shaking palsy. The names Parkinson's disease, shaking palsy, and paralysis agitans all refer to the same illness. There is some good news. True Parkinson's disease progresses slowly. Even after the symptoms have become clear enough to allow a definitive diagnosis, it is usually years, maybe 10 or more years, before a person suffers from a serious disability. Further, treatments are available that relieve symptoms so that years, sometimes a decade or more, can go by before symptoms have a significant impact on a person's quality of life. In people who have Parkinson's disease, specific groups of brain cells called neurons are slowly and progressively injured, then selectively degenerate or die. This process causes the typical symptoms of Parkinson's disease, which doctors call characteristic symptoms because they are the major features of Parkinson's. In this book, when we say symptoms are characteristic of or characterize a disorder, we mean they are typical of that particular disorder and distinguish it from others. These are the characteristic symptoms of Parkinson's disease. People who have Parkinson's may tremble involuntarily. They find their muscles become rigid and stiff, and they lose their ability to make rapid, spontaneous movements. They walk in a recognizable manner with a typical gait in which the body is bent or flexed, and they may have difficulty maintaining their balance. These symptoms do not emerge all at once. For example, walking may become slower and may not worsen for years. Balance is unlikely to be a problem until the more advanced stages, and tremor, the most recognizable feature, does not occur in everyone. The characteristic symptoms of moderate Parkinson's disease can be remembered with the acronym TRAP. T is for tremor and R for rigidity. A is for akinesia, meaning literally lack of movement, referring to the loss of spontaneous or voluntary movement and loss of fluid motion. The slowing down rather than complete loss of movement is called bradykinesia. P is for postural instability, which involves difficulties with balance and the risk of falling, Table 1.1. Parkinson's has neither a cure nor any treatment to slow down its progression. Furthermore, the signs and symptoms of early Parkinson's are only subtly different from those of other neurologic diseases, some more serious and some less serious than Parkinson's. The similarities among these diseases can make diagnosis difficult, and as frustrating as it may be for a person who has Parkinson's symptoms, often the only way to identify Parkinson's disease for sure is to wait and see. What happens in Parkinson's disease? In Parkinson's disease, neurons, nerve cells of the brain area known as the substantia nigra, Latin for black substance, are primarily affected, figure 1.1. When neurons in the substantia nigra degenerate, the brain's ability to generate body movements is disrupted, and this disruption produces signs and symptoms characteristic of Parkinson's disease: tremor, rigidity, akinesia, lack of movement or loss of spontaneous movement, and bradykinesia, slowness of movement, and problems with walking and posture. Other areas of the brain are also affected, especially later in the disease, and it is this aspect of the disease that likely accounts for the broad spectrum of symptoms that can eventually be a part of the illness. The symptoms of any brain disease are determined in part by the location of the neurons that degenerate. For example, Alzheimer's disease involves the degeneration of neurons of the cerebral cortex and results in memory loss and mental deterioration. In amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, ALS, or Lou Gehrig's disease, the selective death of motor neurons in the spinal cord and brain causes profound motor weakness. Again, in Parkinson's disease, the affected neurons are especially those located in the substantia nigra, an area of the brain that is important for control and regulation of motor activity, movement. What causes the symptoms? The substantia nigra is a very small area located deep within the brain. There is one substantia nigra on the right side of the brain and one on the left, but for ease of discussion, the medical literature refers to them as if they were a single structure. The symptoms of Parkinson's disease do not become noticeable until about 50 to 70% of the cells of the substantia nigra have died, because the human nervous system has multiple safety factors and redundancies built into it. For a long time, these safety factors are able to take over the activities of the dying cells. In autopsies of persons who had Parkinson's disease, the brain appears to be relatively normal, except that the substantia nigra has lost its usual black pigment, figure 1.2. Under the microscope, we can see substantially fewer cells in this substantia nigra than in that of healthy brains, and the remaining cells often show signs of abnormality. One hallmark of Parkinson's disease is the presence of small bodies known as Lewy bodies within the remaining substantia nigra cells. The substantia nigra accounts for an extremely small percentage of the brain's weight, but because of its important electrochemical connections with motor centers, brain centers that control movement, it is a vital component in how we move. Specifically, a series of complicated electrical and chemical events within the brain transmits information from neuron to neuron. The chemicals that brain cells use to communicate with one another are called neurotransmitters, or more generally, neurochemicals. The specific neurotransmitter produced and used by the substantia nigra is dopamine. When the cells of the substantia nigra degenerate and die, dopamine is lost and dopamine-relayed messages to other motor centers cannot go through. This is the primary cause of most of the motor symptoms in Parkinson's disease. Recent technological advances in imaging techniques allow visualization of the dopaminergic cells in the substantia nigra in the living brain, figure 1.3. Several different types of imaging can be used, including positron emission tomography, PET, or single photon emission computerized tomography, SPECT. These techniques combine biology, pharmacology, computerized systems, and special laboratories to make radiopharmaceuticals that can be injected in patients and seen during imaging. One test that is now available is SPECT. A particular type of SPECT scan is the DATScan. Although this test can distinguish normal from abnormal dopamine pathways, whether or not it will be helpful in diagnosis remains to be seen. We will discuss the advantages and disadvantages of this test in Chapter 8. There is more. While the loss of dopamine-producing cells is the primary neurochemical disturbance in Parkinson's, the neurochemical disturbances are not limited to the cells of the substantia nigra and to the loss of dopamine. Other small nuclear centers within the brain, for example, the regions called the dorsal motor nucleus of the vagus and the locus coeruleus, also are affected by the degeneration. In Parkinson's disease, as the concentrations of dopamine in the brain decline, so do concentrations of other neurotransmitters, such as norepinephrine and serotonin, although changes in these other neurotransmitters are not nearly as significant as the loss of dopamine. These neurotransmitter and cell changes are spread widely throughout the brain, which may help explain why dopamine replacement does not correct all the problems caused by Parkinson's. For example, dopamine replacement is very helpful for slowness, bradykinesia, and rigidity, but generally is not helpful for balance. In short, Parkinson's disease is not just a dopamine deficiency state. Although we have some understanding that neurochemical disturbance causes the symptoms of Parkinson's, we still do not know what causes the neurodegradation, although extensive scientific research has been conducted in this area. For this reason, the disease is sometimes termed idiopathic, cause unknown, Parkinson's disease. In Chapter 2, we discuss what the current research indicates, and in Chapter 18, we investigate some leads that may shed light on the causes. Because the brain's neurotransmitters, especially dopamine, are so important to the central nervous system's control of the muscles, when these neurotransmitters are in short supply, the muscles act strangely. The central mechanism that controls muscle tone is altered. The muscles may tighten up at inappropriate times. Rapid tightening and releasing of muscles produces a tremor. Sometimes the muscles tighten up and become stiff and rigid. With inadequate communication between the brain and the muscles, movement also becomes slow. Muscles cannot make quick, fluid, spontaneous movements. The central mechanism that controls muscle tone does not function adequately for the delicate interplay of muscles required to help us stand, walk, and balance. In addition, because Parkinson's disease also affects the autonomic nervous system, the largely unconscious system that controls our body temperature, digestive system, sexual function, and bladder control, among other functions, these systems may also act oddly. In true Parkinson's disease, the first symptoms differ only slightly from the normal state and progress slowly, perhaps over decades. Different people have different combinations of symptoms. Parkinsonism. Any person who has the signs and symptoms characteristic of Parkinson's disease, tremor, rigidity, slowness of movement or loss of spontaneous movement, and postural impairment, is said to have Parkinsonism. But not every person who has Parkinsonism has Parkinson's disease. Parkinsonism has many possible causes, and Parkinson's disease is only one of the possibilities. For example, Parkinsonism may be the result of a stroke or a side effect of certain medications. Many other types of neurodegenerative disorders result in Parkinsonism, although Parkinson's disease is the most common of these. In many cases, the Parkinsonism found in these other disorders is due to damage to the substantia nigra, and more often than not, the damage extends to other brain areas as well. People who have Parkinsonism may have symptoms of impaired movement, thinking, behavior, and other body functions, such as blood pressure and sexual, bladder, and bowel function, that people who have true Parkinson's are less likely to develop. Even considering such differences, Parkinson's disease can be very difficult to distinguish from other forms of Parkinsonism. Patients and their families need to understand Parkinsonism because some 20 to 25% of people diagnosed with Parkinson's disease will eventually be discovered to have some other form of Parkinsonism. Parkinsonism may look like Parkinson's disease, but over time it does not act like it. Differences that were subtle at the beginning of a disorder often become more pronounced as it progresses. For people who have Parkinsonism, the symptoms may become more disabling more quickly or may progress more slowly than in Parkinson's disease. Parkinsonism symptoms may or may not respond to the medications used to treat Parkinson's disease. A number of other disorders that include involuntary tremor are not, strictly speaking, a type of Parkinsonism, but can also be mistaken for Parkinson's disease. If you have been diagnosed with Parkinson's, but observe that your symptoms are not characteristic of Parkinson's disease as described in this book, you may have another form of Parkinsonism or a different type of disease altogether. Table 1.2. What will happen to me if I have Parkinson's? Because Parkinson's disease is a progressive disorder, we can generally expect that each year the signs and symptoms of the disease will become more pronounced. With effective treatment, the symptoms may be so effectively masked that for some time it may seem that the disease is not changing, especially in the early years. Over time, however, even with treatment, most people who have Parkinson's do notice increasing problems. No one, not a physician or anyone else, can accurately predict how or how quickly the disease will progress in a specific individual. There simply is no reliable way to evaluate the degree of cell loss in the substantia nigra, no laboratory test or widely available imaging procedure that can tell us how much cell loss has occurred or how fast it is progressing. Even the new imaging techniques cannot predict severity or progression of disease. We can say that Parkinson's is not the kind of disease in which, within a 12-month period, someone who is able to walk and function independently suddenly finds herself or himself incapacitated and wheelchair-bound. In the average patient, the disorder is very slowly and gradually progressive over years, with relatively mild and subtle changes occurring in the first months to years of the illness. Although we can't predict how the disease will progress in a specific individual, we do try to answer the questions patients naturally have about the course of their disease. Why? Because people need to know how long they can expect to remain employed or fully self-sufficient. They need to know how their disease will progress for financial, employment, and social planning reasons. Disease progression varies greatly from one person to another. Some persons have a relatively rapid progression, beginning to experience significant physical disability within 5 years. Others do not reach this state of disability for 15 years. Sometimes these different disease courses are separated into benign and malignant forms. In our experience, most so-called malignant cases of Parkinson's disease have proved to be other diseases, which in their early stages were mimicking true Parkinson's disease. A person's history with the disease is the best guide to the character of his or her illness in the future. In other words, a person's disease usually progresses at about the same rate that he or she has already experienced. This means that predictions are particularly difficult for people newly diagnosed with Parkinson's disease because we have no information about how their disease has progressed so far. General information may be the best we can offer. In general, then, we say that when Parkinson's disease is diagnosed early and when medications are used judiciously, people may experience 5 to 10 years of motor symptoms that do not substantially interfere with their quality of life. Again, Parkinson's disease is not the kind of disease in which rapid deterioration occurs over a few months. Although we do not yet have treatments capable of slowing or arresting the progression of the illness, current treatments can very effectively relieve the symptoms, especially in the early years. As mentioned, many persons who are adequately treated notice very little or no progression of symptoms over the first few years. Although we cannot slow the progression of the underlying illness, patients benefit greatly because reducing the symptoms delays disability in Parkinson's disease. However, with time, a person's degree of motor disability does tend to increase, and after 5 to 10 years of illness, the symptoms generally begin to disrupt daily life. At this point, medications are needed in higher doses and must be monitored and adjusted more frequently. Treatment. Dramatic breakthroughs have been made in the management of Parkinson's disease, most notably the introduction of levodopa almost half a century ago, and subsequently the use of dopamine agonists and later deep brain stimulation. As noted, current treatment can significantly relieve people's symptoms, delay disability, and markedly improve their quality of life. Unfortunately, there is as yet no cure. Treatment is discussed in more detail in chapters 11 through 16. The first stage of treatment for Parkinson's is an accurate diagnosis. This is tricky, as we have noted, particularly early in the disorder when distinguishing Parkinson's disease from other diseases with similar symptoms is particularly difficult. It may be helpful to see a neurologist who is experienced with what are called movement disorders. A movement disorder specialist has expertise in diagnosing and treating Parkinson's disease and related disorders. A visit to a movement disorder center may also be useful. Most such centers are connected with a department of neurology at a medical school, although some are freestanding clinics. The centers have access to appropriate rehabilitation facilities and are usually involved in research studies. We believe patients' involvement in research studies is a good idea for several reasons. First, treatment of Parkinson's disease can be improved when people who have Parkinson's consent to participate in programs that test drugs, so there is an altruistic motive for some people. Second, in clinical research trials, new treatments are tested on patients in carefully planned studies designed or monitored by physicians and statisticians, and people in these trials might have access to helpful drugs years before the drugs are available to others. Finally, people who participate in clinical trials tend to do better than people who do not, even when the people in trials are receiving a placebo or sugar pill rather than a drug. This is because participants in clinical trials receive intense medical attention and monitoring. They are working with people who are especially interested in their disease. They are actively participating in controlling their disease, and they feel better. You can find the names of movement disorder specialists by consulting Parkinson's disease patient organizations or by calling teaching hospitals associated with medical schools. Many of the Parkinson's disease websites for laypersons have lists of neurologists specializing in movement disorders. You can also write to the Movement Disorder Society or the American Academy of Neurology or go to their website, www.movementdisorders.org or www.aan.com, and get information on how to obtain the names of movement disorder specialists in your geographic region. Even if you live some distance from a specialist neurologist or specialist center, you may want to consider traveling to a specialist or center on one or more occasions for a confirming diagnosis, a second opinion, or a treatment plan. Often a specialist who is consulted in this way will remain available to your internist or your family doctor for consultation by telephone. For example, people living in, say, Montana might, if they can afford it, go to the Mayo Clinic to visit a specialist. On returning home, care can generally be coordinated with a local neurologist or family doctor. Sometimes patients who live a long way from a specialist or center monitor their own symptoms and, rather than playing phone tag, they fax or email their questions to the specialist's office. The specialist then answers with recommendations. This is not the best possible system, but sometimes it is the best that can be managed. Increasingly, physicians and movement disorder centers are offering telemedicine care for patients living a long distance from the center. Find out whether this option is available in your area. Patients who belong to a health maintenance organization, HMO, usually are obliged to use the HMO's doctors unless they get a special referral for someone outside the organization. The HMO may have its own neurologist. If you are in an HMO that does not have a neurologist, lobby firmly for a special referral. When should I tell my family, friends, and coworkers? As we note later in this book, family members, spouses, children, siblings, are often the first to notice symptoms in the person who has Parkinson's disease. They may notice a change in the way a person walks or stands or in the person's facial expression. But even if family members haven't yet noticed any symptoms in the person who has Parkinson's, they will notice them as time goes on. If you have been diagnosed with Parkinson's, rather than letting people close to you wonder and worry about what's wrong, it is generally best to tell them about the disease and that you are being treated for it. You can also assure them it is not a contagious disease and that except in a minority of families, there is little evidence that it is passed from one generation to another. Family members will share your concerns, of course, perhaps especially about the uncertainty of the future, the progression of the symptoms. But sharing your concerns as a family is almost always better than one person braving it out alone. And this way, too, the family can make plans for the future, perhaps taking that cross-country trip now rather than putting it off for years, as well as putting some savings away. You would not be able to hide the symptoms of Parkinson's disease from your family indefinitely, and for this and these other reasons, our advice is to tell your family. Choose a place and time when you and they are comfortable, not stressed, and make sure you have lots of time to talk and share your feelings. If there are problems or tensions in your family that might make the telling difficult or even traumatic, you might want to enlist the help of a professional counselor or social worker who can either advise you on how to break the news or be with you and your family during this time. Deciding on the best time to tell an employer and colleagues about a Parkinson's diagnosis is often difficult. A person carrying a full load of responsibilities at work is naturally concerned that people will become uncertain about his or her ability to function if they learn about the diagnosis of a chronic illness. And people do sometimes react this way. Nonetheless, if you are in this situation, it is not a good idea to suppress information about your illness for too long. If your coworkers do not know about the disease, they might get some very wrong ideas. They might think the tremor means nervousness or anxiety, the masked face means boredom or displeasure, and the soft voice means a lack of conviction. Parkinson's disease is a difficult disease to hide anyway. People with a tremor would need to make up excuses about why their hand shakes. Or, if they try to hide the tremor, they might become quite anxious, which makes the tremor worse. Most people decide it is just better to say, "I have Parkinson's." Although Parkinson's is a fairly common disease, what most people know about it is often based on their experience with a relative or friend from some years ago. They probably aren't aware that the new medications are much better at managing the symptoms, or that people who have the disease can continue to function well. So, once you make the decision to share this news with coworkers, keep in mind that they will react better to the news if you educate them a bit about how the disease does and does not affect you. When people who have Parkinson's were asked about their experience disclosing their diagnosis in the workplace, the majority reported that the news was received better than they expected. There are other considerations. The Federal Americans with Disabilities Act, ADA, signed into law in 1990, states that in a company with more than 15 employees, the company is required to make reasonable accommodations in the workplace so that a person with a disability can continue to work. The ADA bans discrimination in employment against qualified persons with disabilities. If oral presentations are a large part of your job, you may have difficulty if your voice becomes softer and more monotonous. Microphones and speaker systems can be used to make the presentations audible even to a large audience, however, so that your work can go on. If you must have steady hands in your job, you may find your colleagues are alarmed by the tremor, even though it disappears when you are moving. You may need to explain about this aspect of tremor and demonstrate your abilities. Eventually, if tremor does become a problem, you may need to take on different tasks and responsibilities and give up tasks requiring a steady hand. Also, if stress and emotional intensity make the tremor worse, you may need to take care to avoid stressful situations. The mood changes that sometimes appear early in Parkinson's may pose a problem for some people in a work situation. For example, someone with depression may find it very difficult to work effectively. Medical treatment of the depression generally helps with both the depression and effectiveness at work. A person who becomes unusually anxious in situations that previously would not have caused such distress may find medications can help relieve the anxiety. For many people, continuing to work and be productive is an important factor in adjusting to the diagnosis of Parkinson's disease. For others, symptoms such as fatigue and reduced tolerance to stress may make it difficult to cope with previous work demands, so approaches to work need to be individualized. By now, it is clear why patients and doctors alike understand that defining Parkinson's disease is both straightforward and elusive. The straightforward part is that we can describe Parkinson's disease as a specific neurologic disorder in which the destruction of specific centers within the brain disrupts people's control of movement. The disorder primarily involves a chemical deficiency of the neurotransmitter dopamine and, as we'll discuss in chapters 11 and 12, the replacement of dopamine significantly relieves the characteristic disease features of tremor, rigidity, slowness of movement, and difficulty with balance and posture. What remains elusive is a precise definition and description of Parkinson's, as well as any understanding of its fundamental cause or causes. And progress of the disease varies significantly among people with the same signs and symptoms, and perhaps the same diagnosis, and we don't know why. Here is the closest we can come to defining Parkinson's disease at this time. It is a slowly progressive neurodegenerative disease that has the characteristic motor symptoms of tremor, rigidity, slowness of movement, and gait and balance problems. Administering anti-Parkinson medications can relieve these symptoms. The degeneration in Parkinson's that accounts for many of the motor features occurs in the substantia nigra and the regions of the brain's motor control system downstream from the substantia nigra. A number of other diseases have some of these characteristics, but only Parkinson's disease has all of them. We also recognize that Parkinson's is more than a motor disorder and is more than a group of problems due to dopamine deficiency. As we learn more about the disease, we hope to understand not only what causes it, but how it can be treated more effectively and, someday, how it can be prevented. In the next chapter, we discuss who gets Parkinson's disease. Then we turn, in Chapter 3, to a description of the early symptoms. Chapter 2. Who gets Parkinson's disease? How common is Parkinson's disease? Is Parkinson's related to aging? Is it inherited? Is it triggered by environmental factors? What do we know about the causes of Parkinson's? When physicians make a diagnosis of any serious disease, patients and their families often ask, "Why me?" In the case of Parkinson's disease, the question, "Why me?" is actually quite profound. The attempt to answer this question has occupied clinical researchers for many years. The shortest and most direct answer is that, as of now, we don't know why one person develops Parkinson's and another does not. Science and medicine have told us some things about Parkinson's, but we still have much to learn. For example, although Parkinson's appears to be one of the most common neurodegenerative diseases in the United States and Canada, even after extensive studies, we don't know for sure how many people have it, or who will get it, or why. In this chapter, we discuss what we do know and present some educated theories about why people get Parkinson's. First, though, it's helpful to consider the two major categories of all disease causation, what causes a particular disease, genetic and environmental, nature and nurture. Hereditary or genetic diseases run in families and are passed from parent to child as part of the DNA, the genetic material that makes a person uniquely himself or herself. Environmental diseases are caused by something outside a person. This book considers environmental disease to be a disease caused by anything outside a person, anything other than a person's genetic material. Toxins, drugs, and even viruses or bacteria can be environmental causes of disease. Even though the cause of Parkinson's remains elusive, in recent years there has been considerable interest in the possible role of genetics. The advances in technology allowing for more and more sophisticated examinations of the human genome result in more in-depth exploration of a possible genetic role in Parkinson's. During the same time, a number of population studies looking for environmental associations with the onset of Parkinson's have reported that exposure to herbicides and pesticides, or certain solvents, frequency of bowel movements, although this could also be a very early feature of the disease, lower coffee consumption, smoking, and lower blood urate levels may somehow contribute to the development of the disease. Most people who have Parkinson's cannot recall anyone else in their family having the disease, which would seem to rule out a very strong genetic cause in the majority of cases. And if environment were a cause, we might expect that persons married to each other for a long time and sharing a similar environment would both be affected by the disease, but such cases are rare. The picture, then, is complex. Parkinson's disease may well be caused by a combination of genetic and environmental factors. Certain inherited characteristics might make it either more or less likely that a person will develop Parkinson's. For example, a person may inherit a predisposition to Parkinson's, but he or she will not develop the disease unless exposed to an environmental trigger of the disease, such as a toxin. Another person may have a genetic makeup that protects against Parkinson's, even if she or he is exposed to the same toxin. Different combinations and amounts of genetic and environmental factors could also account for the differences between people's symptoms and the course of the disease. Put another way, person A with genetic predisposition A and environmental trigger A might have more severe Parkinson's symptoms than person B with genetic predisposition A and environmental trigger B. Person C might have a protective genetic component C and not get Parkinson's at all, even after exposure to triggers A or B. Other combinations would yield different levels or non-levels of disease. degenerative diseases usually are not caused by infections or metabolic disturbances or insufficient blood supply to the affected region, in this case the substantia nigra. The cause of most neurodegenerative diseases remains unknown and is the focus of considerable research. Doctors and scientists are continuing to search for answers to the clearly complex question of what causes Parkinson's, and they will almost certainly succeed in unraveling some of the mysteries. How common is Parkinson's? Parkinson's disease is fairly common. A number of well-known people, many of whom are still working and changing the world, have been diagnosed with this disease. We estimate that in North America, between 750,000 and 1 million people, slightly more men than women, have Parkinson's disease. For a variety of reasons, we don't know exactly how many. One reason is that many people are misdiagnosed. Either their Parkinson's has not been recognized yet, or they have been diagnosed with Parkinson's but actually have some other disorder. And some people have not yet sought medical care for their symptoms. The best we can do is make estimates based on the widely varying results from door-to-door surveys, diagnoses of people admitted to hospitals, prescriptions for anti-Parkinson drugs, and information given on death certificates. We also don't know whether Parkinson's is more common in some racial groups than in others. Several studies have suggested that the frequency of Parkinson's disease is higher in Caucasian American than in African American populations, but the results of these studies are difficult to accept. African Americans generally have less access than Caucasian Americans to medical care, particularly neurologic care, and accurate diagnosis of Parkinson's disease requires a person trained in and familiar with neurologic disorders. Thus, the reported racial differences may result from an inequality of medical care delivery in the United States. In one study at a specialized Parkinson's referral center in Baltimore, Maryland, African-American Parkinson's patients were found to be visiting the center in small numbers, even though the city was home to a large population of African-Americans. Further investigation showed that the African-American patients generally visited the center at a more advanced stage of Parkinson's and that they had less access than other patients to the newer Parkinson's medications. Another study conducted a door-to-door survey in a multiracial county in Mississippi and found the frequency of Parkinson's disease in blacks and whites to be essentially the same. Other careful surveys indicate a higher occurrence of Parkinson's in Caucasians. In summary, the racial distribution of the disease remains unclear. Parkinson's and aging. An actor wishing to portray an older person might move slowly and stoop over, assuming a flexed posture and perhaps shuffling along and picking up things with trembling hands. The actor's use of features that commonly occur in Parkinson's disease both reflects the association between aging and Parkinson's in the actor's mind and reinforces this association in the popular imagination. The average age of onset of Parkinson's disease is about 60 years. At the beginning of the 20th century, 60 years seemed older than it does today, and the average age of onset of Parkinson's was the same then as now. This may explain the long-held association between Parkinson's disease and aging. Now, though, we cannot say that Parkinson's affects only the elderly, although the number of people who have Parkinson's disease rises as the population ages. The chance of developing Parkinson's does increase as we age. Also, 60 is only the average age of onset. About 80% of all people who have Parkinson's develop the disorder between 40 and 70, and about 5% develop it between 20 and 40. The latter, so-called young-onset Parkinson's disease, is difficult to diagnose, primarily because neither physicians nor patients tend to think about Parkinson's disease in persons in their 30s. The relationship between normal aging and the course and features of Parkinson's disease is hotly debated. Some researchers argue that everyone would eventually develop Parkinson's if they lived long enough because, in the normal process of aging, the dopamine-containing neurons of the substantia nigra, so essential for normal motor function, become dysfunctional and die. This position is not quite supported by the current evidence, which indicates that normal aging alone does not cause Parkinson's. It is true that once the substantia nigra is damaged by whatever does cause Parkinson's disease, the normal age-related loss of cells in the same area may contribute to the development of signs of the disease and possibly to its progression. How much normal aging contributes to the signs, symptoms, and course of Parkinson's remains a hotly debated topic. However, age remains the most important risk factor for Parkinson's disease. Is Parkinson's a hereditary disease? As noted, we do not know whether Parkinson's disease is inherited. For example, when a Parkinson's patient suggests the disease runs in his or her family, and a neurologist trained in the diagnosis of movement disorders examines the affected family members, the neurologist often finds these family members have some other neurologic disorder, not Parkinson's disease. But we do know that if Parkinson's is diagnosed in one member of a family, there is a 10 to 15% chance that someone else in the family has Parkinson's as well. For most people who have Parkinson's, their family history has no pattern that suggests a genetic problem. When doctors inquire about genetic patterns of disease in a family, they are trying to determine whether certain well-known patterns of inheritance exist in that family. For example, are only members of one generation, siblings, affected, so-called recessive inheritance, or does the disease seem to pass from one generation to another, so-called dominant inheritance? Even if in some families Parkinson's disease does occur in more than one generation or in brothers and sisters, we must remember that Parkinson's is common enough that coincidence might be playing a role. Studies with identical twins seem to indicate that heredity alone does not cause Parkinson's in most patients. The medical profession considers such studies the best possible test, the gold standard, for determining whether a disease is genetic. Identical twins inherit the same genetic material, so if one twin develops a hereditary disease, the chances are very high that the other one will eventually develop it too. One very large National Institutes of Health study of Parkinson's disease identified 43 identical twin pairs in which one twin had Parkinson's, as diagnosed by specially trained movement disorder experts. When these experts evaluated the other twin of each pair, they found that among all 43 pairs, only in one pair did both twins have Parkinson's. Two other twin studies, one in England and another in Finland, have reported similar findings. This evidence indicates that inheritance probably does not play a predominant role in Parkinson's. The evidence was made stronger by the finding that even after re-examination of the twins some years later, when any previously unobserved Parkinson's symptoms should have surfaced, the incidence of both twins having Parkinson's disease remained extremely low. A more recent twin study using a twin registry started by the federal government during World War II also demonstrated an extremely low occurrence of Parkinson's disease in both identical twins. Further, in this study, the twins were examined at a much older age, so it is unlikely that a genetic influence on Parkinson's could have been missed. This study indicated that in patients with a younger age of onset, genetics did have a stronger role to play than in those with an older age of onset. Even though it is still true that for an individual diagnosed with Parkinson's, there is little chance of passing the disease to the next generation, we have learned a tremendous amount about genes and Parkinson's in the last 10 years. When this new information began to emerge from laboratories around the world, the findings of abnormal genes in certain families with Parkinson's seemed unusual and difficult to understand. The developing story of the role of abnormal genes in Parkinson's has greatly increased our understanding of the basic chemical abnormalities in the brain in Parkinson's disease. The most important outcome of this new understanding is that it opens new avenues for pursuing better treatment for people who have Parkinson's. Some of these newly discovered Parkinson's genes are the alpha-synuclein gene, Parkin, DJ1, PINK1, and LRRK2, as well as GBA, the gene known to cause Gaucher's disease. The first Parkinson's disease gene was found in one very large Italian-American family. In this family, almost half the children of any family member with Parkinson's will develop the disease. This extraordinary family can trace its history for many generations both in North America and in Italy, and these data allowed researchers to locate a genetic abnormality responsible for a type of Parkinson's disease. The genetic abnormality in this family occurs in the alpha-synuclein gene, that is, the gene that directs the synthesis of alpha-synuclein, a brain protein located, among other places, in synaptic membranes, membranes vital to the transmission of chemical signals within the brain. Alpha-synuclein is also present in the abnormal cellular structures called Lewy bodies, found in the brain cells of almost everyone with Parkinson's disease. How relevant is this genetic abnormality to other people who have Parkinson's? Given that most patients' families reveal only weak or non-existent familial patterns of Parkinson's disease, and that this Italian family history is unusual, we don't know whether the abnormality is important to most people with the disease. In fact, scientists have failed to find this abnormal gene in most people who have typical Parkinson's disease. However, the importance of alpha-synuclein has been further confirmed by the findings that other mutations in the gene cause forms of Parkinsonism, and that the presence of too much of the gene, and thus the protein, also causes disease, with the amount of the excess gene and protein being related to the severity of the disease. The second gene discovered, the Parkin gene, is responsible for a form of young-onset Parkinsonism. It was first discovered in Japan, but researchers have since found this gene in various populations around the world. Although at first considered rare, it is now known to probably occur in approximately 10% of people whose disease began before age 40. It is becoming apparent that genetic influence in families is more likely if the person who has Parkinson's in that family has an early age of onset, usually before 40 years old. Other new genes discovered to play a role in families affected with Parkinson's include PINK1, DJ1, LRRK2, GBA, and most recently VPS35. The LRRK2 gene has proved to be the most commonly known genetic cause of so-called dominantly inherited Parkinson's and has also been found in a small proportion of seemingly non-hereditary cases. Dominantly inherited means that a characteristic is passed from parent to child 50% of the time, or, put another way, that a child has a 1 in 2 chance of inheriting it. Additional genes associated with Parkinson's will certainly be discovered. Using genome-wide association studies, GWAS, a number of genes already have been found to possibly increase the risk of Parkinson's disease. All of these new Parkinson's genes are beginning to open up further areas of research that will ultimately lead to new treatments for symptoms and even to slowing the disease itself. Scientists have learned about cell processes in Parkinson's disease that play an important role in how the disease evolves both in families with the abnormal gene and in patients with no family history of the disease. For example, the cellular process by which abnormal proteins in the cell are handled has become a focus of research. Some of the newly discovered genes help to regulate how these abnormally made cellular proteins are removed from the cell. One theory is that abnormal proteins inside the nerve cells of the substantia nigra and other brain areas cause these regions to degenerate and die. As we have discussed, when the substantia nigra degenerates, Parkinson's symptoms emerge. Researchers believe that the abnormal genes disrupt normal processes carried out by cellular systems known as the ubiquitin proteasome system and the lysosome autophagy system for removing bad or abnormal proteins. This removal process is very important to keeping nerve cells healthy. It is now apparent that typical Parkinson's signs and symptoms, resting tremor, rigidity, slowness, gait, and balance problems, good response to levodopa, the emergence of motor fluctuations and dyskinesias, discussed later, and unilateral onset can be seen in genetically determined Parkinson's. This is an extraordinary discovery, and even though the overall percentage of families with these genetic abnormalities remains low, the fact that there are several different distinct genes that cause Parkinson's has awakened the research community to the vast possibilities that lie ahead to better understand the basic mechanisms responsible for Parkinson's disease and to create better treatments. These new genetic discoveries, combined with a rapidly advancing technology used in genetic analysis, has led to the beginning of a technique known as GWAS, genome-wide association studies. In these studies, the entire human genome is looked at for clues to the cause of Parkinson's. Even more exciting is the use of gene sequencing techniques, which are becoming more widely available and will allow an individual patient's genome to be analyzed to look for clues into the origin of their Parkinson's. In addition to the traditional forms of inheritance, which we have already discussed, dominant, generation to generation, and recessive, siblings only, these new techniques and studies allow the research field to expand into examining Parkinson's as a complex genetic disorder, in which it may be found that one abnormal gene is not responsible for the clinical symptoms of Parkinson's. Rather, arrays of genes may be involved, with each individual gene exerting only a very small effect. When the necessary array of 10, 20, 40 genes is aligned, this may trigger Parkinson's. Although the evidence in recent years has grown stronger that Parkinson's is a complex genetic disorder, environmental triggers have not been eliminated as a potential factor. As an example of this, consider that if a person carries the LRRK2 gene, it does not mean that the person will develop Parkinson's. There are examples of people living to a very elderly age with the LRRK2 gene who never develop Parkinson's. The reason for this is not certain. Is it because the secondary array of genes was not sufficient to trigger Parkinson's, or because the individual never came into contact with some unknown environmental triggering factor? As scientists continue to explore these new avenues of research, we will learn more and more about the fundamental chemical problems both in Parkinson's in families with abnormal genes and in more typical non-familial Parkinson's. This will be the beginning of a vast new understanding of the molecular basis of Parkinson's disease. Environmental factors and Parkinson's. When patients diagnosed with Parkinson's ask, "Why me?" they are often wondering whether they have been exposed to something that could have triggered their disease. Here is what we know about the influence of environmental toxins, drugs or viruses or bacteria on the development of Parkinson's disease. Industrial toxins. The evidence shows a definite maybe for the possibility of environmental toxins as a cause of Parkinson's disease. A number of toxins, including manganese dust, carbon disulfide, and carbon monoxide, have been shown to cause Parkinsonism, but not, according to research so far, Parkinson's disease. Although the symptoms of Parkinson's disease have distinctive, easily recognizable characteristics, there is a surprising absence of mention of these symptoms in the medical literature before James Parkinson's 1817 paper. In part because of this, the theory has been advanced that the frequency of Parkinson's has increased since the Industrial Revolution. If this intriguing idea were to prove true, perhaps Parkinson's could be related to some type of industrial toxin. However, we know that the frequency of Parkinson's disease has not changed from the late 1890s to the present, a period of rapid increase in industrialization, and this would seem to argue against industrial toxins as an important causative factor. In addition, there are very clear older descriptions of Parkinson's disease, including writings from ancient Egypt. The idea that industrialization might increase the incidence of Parkinson's disease also suggests that city dwellers, who are more likely than country dwellers to be exposed to certain industrial pollutants, might also be more likely to develop Parkinson's. Some reports show that city dwellers may well have a higher frequency, but even more studies suggest that rural life predisposes individuals to Parkinson's disease. Country life may entail different environmental exposures, such as substances found in some well water. Again, the evidence is unclear. Environmental studies are difficult to design and carry out with accuracy. Many environmental studies are still underway and may yet reveal the cause of Parkinson's disease, but, As interesting as these conclusions would be, this research is still a work in progress. Sometimes the media report that a specific toxin might be the cause of Parkinson's, and people become concerned. In every case thus far, repeated studies of the same toxin have not supported the earlier findings. A current source of such controversy is the potential for welding to cause Parkinson's disease. Illicit drugs. A number of years ago, a tragic error in the home production of a mind-altering drug provided some intriguing evidence about how environmental toxins might cause Parkinsonism. Young drug users were making a drug called meperidine, which was supposed to produce a euphoric altered state of consciousness. They made a mistake in their preparation, however, and produced a heroin-like compound called MPTP, methylphenyltetrahydropyridine. This substance is capable of causing sudden and dramatic injury to the dopamine-producing cells of the substantia nigra. Some of the young people who injected the drug intravenously suddenly, within 2 to 4 weeks, developed the symptoms of advanced Parkinson's. This tragedy has spawned numerous scientific studies as scientists seek to understand how MPTP injures nerve cells and whether other similar substances are present in our environment. After decades of exploration of MPTP-induced injury of dopamine cells in animal models, this paradigm is being critically reevaluated. Although these studies have been very helpful in understanding the brain's response to dopaminergic injury, the translation of the results of these experiments into clinical trials has been disappointing. In other words, studies of animals subjected to MPTP injury and then treated with another drug to dampen the injury, sometimes called neuroprotection, have been successfully conducted. Unfortunately, when these drugs were tried in patients with early Parkinson's to slow progression, all of them failed. This has led to a search for better animal models of Parkinson's. The roles of viruses or bacteria. There is no evidence that Parkinson's disease results directly from infection with any type of virus or bacteria. Sometimes, but very rarely, a person who has had encephalitis, a brain infection caused by a large variety of viruses, develops Parkinsonism, but the symptoms usually fade within a few days or a month. Historically, though, we can find some evidence for a possible virus-associated Parkinsonism. During the influenza pandemic of 1917 to 1920, a particular type of Parkinsonism developed in people who had a disease called von Ekkommenau's encephalitis. Some of these people suddenly, overnight, developed what we now call Parkinsonism, and some developed it 2 or 3 years later. Unlike people who have more typical post-encephalitic Parkinsonism, these patients did not get better. In general, although encephalitis can cause Parkinsonism.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.